In this section, we'll review how custom weldment tube profiles can be configured for a frame design. We'll start with a sketch that contains two concentric circles with an outer diameter dimension and wall tube thickness dimension. From the heads-up view toolbar, all annotations and dimension names are shown. In this case, D1 and D2 we will reference later when configuring this sketch. Editing this sketch, we see it's fully defined and contains the two dimensions which we may wish to vary for alternate tube sizes. Right-clicking on a sketch and choosing Configure Feature brings us into a window containing a table of alternate sizes. Double-clicking any sketch from the feature tree will add it to the table, and the drop-down arrow to the right of the sketch heading can be used to add the dimensions you wish to configure. Double-clicking on a row will switch to that configuration and update the sketch in real time. Let's create a new 30 by 2mm configuration and modify the dimensions for D1 and D2 accordingly, and then apply the change. Also, be sure to save this table view of parameters so you can quickly access it later on. This can be done from the bottom of the window by entering a name where the prompt is, and then clicking the icon to the left of the box. The sketch parameters are updated correctly, and clicking on the 2mm dimension, we can see the dimension name we've added before the dim code, which acts like a dimension description. Switching over to the configurations tab, we can step through the generated sizes easily, all from within one part file. It's important when saving the file for the first time to select the sketch you wish to use in the weldment tool from the feature manager tree, then navigate to File, Save As, and save as a library feature part with the file extension .sldlfp. In this instance, we will navigate to the default save location. However, you can specify your own location if you do not have access and add this under the file locations for weldment profiles. In the weldment profiles folder, a number of ISO tubes already exist, and a large database of standard profile sizes and shapes can be downloaded for free from SOLIDWORKS. We will save this tube profile in a folder that was created earlier called Formula Student. The weldment profile is correctly set up and saved if a small L symbol appears near the sketch and the file icon in the design tree changes to a stack of books with some extra folders also included in the feature manager tree. You can quickly add or remove a sketch from the library by right-clicking on the context menu. We'll now proceed to start building the chassis frame using the weldment tools, focusing specifically on the front bulkhead structure. Start by right-clicking on any of the Command Manager tabs and ensuring the Weldments option is enabled. We can then click Structural Member and specify the standard, type, and size of tubing to be used. Notice how the drop-down structure follows the folder we stored our tube profile in, the name of the tube profile, and the configurations contained within it. We'll pick the 25.4 by 2.4 mm tube profile and start to form our three safety roll hoop groups. In this group, we will select the connected segments of the main roll hoop, and where there is a joint, a pink dot appears. Weldment groups follow a particular set of rules which are highlighted in this table. Trying to select entities from the mid roll hoop is not possible as the entities are disjointed and are not parallel, so we can form a new group and select the connected sections. This can be repeated for the front roll hoop. Following the logical bend order for a single length of tube means that the horizontal floor members at the base of each hoop are not selected and they will be created separately. Once we have created our first weldment, we can easily edit this feature to review, modify, or add groups for this particular tube size. We will create another weldment feature using a thinner wall tube and select the lower longitudinal member of the front bulkhead and the parallel tube on the opposite side. Attempting to select additional tubes does not work as the members above are slightly inclined and are not parallel, so new groups need to be created separately. The upper members are also not parallel, and we can see this by rotating and noting the slight taper in the members, hence the need for separate groups. In just a few seconds, we have created the main bracing members for the front bulkhead. However, it's obvious that the tubes are currently intersecting one another in the 3D model. We can use the trim extend option on the weldment toolbar to clean up the profiles by selecting the member to be trimmed and the surrounding bodies that will be trimming it. We can toggle options for corner extension type and even a weld gap, which will be required in this case. The end result is a neatly trimmed member with a visible but weld gap all the way around. We can turn this option off to create a flush finish between the tubing if required. For manufacturing, it's better to have a longer weldment and cut back than a member that is too short. Another transverse weldment will be created of a smaller size tube to brace the floor where the pedal box rail will be attached. We can now focus on creating the main X brace for the suspension mounting points. We can select the diagonal members from the bottom left to top right as they are connected end to end, but we need to create new groups to brace from top left to bottom right. Clicking on any purple point where members meet brings up a powerful tool to control the trim order for the desired result. Clicking a row and toggling the trim order gives different outcomes. However, we require all group members to be trimmed at the same time in trim order 2 to achieve a clean, mitered cut where all members slot together perfectly. We'll now review the completed frame and highlight some of the key considerations and design choices, as well as steps to follow when designing a chassis. We can see that a number of additional groups were created in the tree, and some members seem to be interfering with one another. However, this is okay for now, as we'll trim them back later. Working from the cockpit members towards the rear, we have created a group of parallel transverse members that will form the engine cradle and rear bulkhead, and then braced around these. There are some support members missing from the rear bulkhead, so we'll modify the existing profiles and add a new group to include these members. The members are trimmed cleanly at both ends and slot together nicely, and this completes the chassis frame design for now. A number of trim operations have been added at the end of the feature tree to follow best practices, including a trim with ground cut to create a flush floor with no protruding members. We'll now apply a material to the frame to compute overall mass and additional mechanical properties used in later simulations. Right-clicking on the materials heading in the feature tree, we can apply or edit existing materials and pull from the vast range of SOLIDWORKS materials. New in 2020, you can also easily search through the materials using the filter bar at the top. Collapsing the folders, we can see a custom materials folder at the bottom of the tree. In this, we can create new material libraries or new category folders to organize our custom materials. We'll name this folder, then copy and paste an existing material which we can modify with our custom strength data to match any particular material grades that we are using. Useful parameters to extract include mass properties which can be accessed from the Evaluate tab. Here, we can see the new material density that we created, as well as the overall mass of the chassis frame. Clicking the Options button allows us to toggle precision and accuracy settings. Center of mass properties can also be extracted for weight distribution calculations, and a center of mass feature can also be created, which appears in the feature tree and is used as a reference point for suspension roll center calculations or in simulation loading conditions. This feature is also visible in the viewport and can be toggled on or off if it's not initially visible using the heads-up toolbar. We can now move on to the next phase.